I try to be, you know, more audible and be slow. So stop me if you, you know, need clarification or come to us. Because you don't have any mic. I try and be as loud as possible, like 4 minutes. So, starting with my introduction, I'm Sweta and I work for Sweden Technologies for the last 3 years. Before that, I've been associated with multiple companies in the past. At Sweden, I perform multiple roles of, including management role of Scrum Master or Group Leader, along with being a, hands-on performance and security tester. In technology areas, which forces me to try out new things and explore with my team newer technologies. Jenkins was one initiative we tried to incorporate in our project for improving quality. So, before I start with disclaimer that with Jenkins, we are here not attempting automated deployments or checking for code standardization using Jenkins. So, what I am attempting to do is whatever changes we do to our web application when we have a continuous development process, there are going to be a lot of regression happening. So, the tests or the process I've come up with, it will help to minimize regression and create your test with minimum investment of time and effort. So, that's the idea of today's session. Key takeaways are that. After today's session, you will be at least be able to, create some smart tests for your application, irrespective of what technology it is using. So, if even 5 people are able to achieve that, I think my session will be a success. So, let's get started. So, the agenda, I've tried to keep it minimized, not too many items. So first, a background of, why I'm giving this session. What are the challenges in a continuous development environment? Some experiences are what I have experienced in my my career in IT, working with different systems and projects. My recommendations and a small demo. I understand that because the projector is slightly right aligned. I try and help as much as I can so that everybody is able to make the most from this session. So I'll start with a quick background. So, the topic of my talk was how we can leverage continuous integration for web application stability. But what do we understand by stability? In the general terms, can anyone try and define something? What is stability? What do you think is a stable application? Which is true for any kind of release or deployment. And if you ask me an ideal definition of how I would define is irrespective of the number of deployments your web application is going through, the end user should not experience any disruption in his services. Plus, the end user has a right to get all the latest functionalities and the latest technologies that your platform or application has to offer. Minimum or no disruption, which means that even if you are having 100 plus deployments in a day, users should not get even a single deployment. That, according to me, would be a perfectly stable application. And very people are able to achieve that with different tools and processes in place and standardization of processes. So, some other formal definitions of web application stability could be how well your hardware performs, how many requests it is able to handle without any disruption or degradation in performance, if there are 100 concurrent users or more. What is the maximum time required to serve a request or load a page, in common terms, when there is a lot of load? People say that IRCTC is not working because there are not many people. But that's the application that is so widely and heavily used. It's such a constant technology to keep that site good performing. But you know, leaving those, you know, high traffic sites, or even you can say Facebook and other social networking, which going through a lot of constant traffic and continuous deployments as well, we hardly see any downtime in those applications. It means there are a lot of processes in place which are ensuring the end user has no impact. I think we've covered the definition as well. So, you know, and how we can ensure that, you know, there is minimum or no disruption, and whatever is the intention of a particular deployment, you know, end users are able to enjoy that. So for that, regression testing is the word. You know, and you all know that for every code change, we do a lot of regression testing. Right? So, and at times we don't know how to judge whether, you know, this change will have a big impact, so that we do a complete regression or you know, a partial regression will be enough. But sometimes an effect is, a side effect is not clear. We don't even know, you know, that this change could cause an unwanted side effect. So these are some reasons why, you know, we need a good regression testing strategy, which means, you know, that's the best way to ensure software quality. So it is a preventive mechanism, so that, you know, before your end users find a, you know, a 503 error on your website, you are able to figure that out, you know, with your regression tests. Also, you know, the other challenge why regression is important is that, you know, in addition to the code changes, there are other changes also that we need to take care of, like the version of the framework. So, if people are, you know, working in Drupal, there's a constant upgrades or updates in different code than you want to create models. And we need to be constantly updated because there are a lot of security patches, plus, you know, working version of code and contributed modules coming up. So, there could be scenarios where even a contribution would not, you know, be your side down if you are upgrading to a latest version of a contributed module. Depending on how you have used that module in your site, project, there could be n number of changes coming in a week's time. And if a code phase happens every week, so which particular change caused that regression? Whose code or which commit it was that caused this regression? Very difficult to pinpoint. So, which lines of code introduced a degradation in the performance? Sometimes it's not easy or practical to find out. So, what can we do? So this is my definition of an ideal regression cycle. For here, I'm assuming that a project does not have any test cases in place, any regression in place already. A regression test case should not only cover only the functional aspects, as in functionality or features, but it should also cover performance as a key regression areas. Because in these times, this is one of the key attributes of any successful web application. So that should again be a part of our regression cycle. So if it's a new project that you're starting with, my recommendations are that we have functional tests for both, a mix of user roles that your system has. Maybe if it's just a anonymous user site, you have a mix of both scenarios for anonymous as well as for the different roles. To start with, you can just start with the scenarios covered for anonymous users, or just get requests which are just doing fetch from the web server.
Go down. 11, I think.
my name, which is SWETASHHI / Drupal test. So where I have the template jmeter scripts already in place. So, you know, even with no knowledge of jmeter, we just directly download these two files. The template scripts that I have, I'll just show you how the scripts looks like and how you can modify it. Okay. So I'll go over to the demo and then come back to the presentation. Now you may say that an application cannot be tested only by the get request, which is very fair statement, because there are a lot of scenarios which are actually post requests or form submissions or registration, those kind of scenarios where an action by the user causes a modification at the server side or changes the state or behavior of the application. So for those scenarios, that is actually the next step, you know, in this automation, where you can record those scenarios in tools like Figure, which captures the HTTP request format, and then we create those requests in JMeter. So it requires a little bit of familiarity, but you know, in case of beginners who are very new to JMeter or Jenkins, these scripts are very handy. They can be, you know, used as it is. So here I have created a template script for performance testing. I've commented out the login steps, because you know, here we are doing a performance test for the anonymous users of the site. So say for example, any e-commerce platform will generally have more traffic of anonymous users than login users. So you know, it makes sense that for performance testing, you identify those scenarios which are more frequently used. I've also mentioned a principle in my slide, which I'll go back to later. So you know, if you click on this request, this is a HTTP request which has a parameterized path. So I'm assuming this is for anonymous users. Now this path I've defined in my user-defined variables here. So here you'll see some set of variables which can be changed in only one place and does not require any modification in the script. So say, you know, I have to test these three requests. So I'll create request 1, 2, and 3 here and give the parameterized path value. So say my protocol being followed is HTTP. The URL of my site is mysitedev.com, which I just used as an example. And these are the different paths that I want my script to traverse and do a performance testing. So search, or search with a query string, or at the home page. Okay. So this was a walkthrough of my the template scripts and how we can modify them.
Running the build, the system asks me where you want to run the test on. So
I'll say now I want to run on staging, so I can provide that parameter at runtime while running the test. So you know, this is an example of that. And then we can also do a build periodically. So as per my recommendation, or how we are following in our current projects, is that we are doing, you know, these performance tests and the functional tests every day. So every day at 9 a.m. or at 8 a.m., we are taking these tests that we have in place. And we can specify a schedule here. Just write star space 9 space star. One more star.
HTML, which will attach the HTML report in your email. So once
you save this configuration, you're almost done for your project. So other than, you know, constantly upgrading your tests by adding more URLs to your jmeter scripts and pushing them onto Git, there's nothing that you need to take care of, because your tests are anyways going to run every day and the reports are going to be mailed every day. With teams using Slack and other, you know, collaboration tools, you could also integrate Slack with, you know, Jenkins and have these messages posted at runtime on Slack as well. So if we go back to the presentation. So as I was saying that, you know, choosing what should be chosen as the criteria for what to test. So I've used this FAB principle, which means the most frequently used URLs, the architecturally complex pieces, or whatever is business critical, they should be a part of your test, even if they are post requests or get requests. Right? So all this should be included in our jmeter scripts. And you need to obviously constantly upgrade and maintain your tests. Maintenance is slightly low, but the only thing is you need to add more URLs to your jmeter files as and when, you know, there are more scenarios or pages added to your web application. So I'll show some examples. So this is a jmeter report that gets mailed to us. So if there is a failure, so that's how we have configured. The reports are emailed on failure, but success and failure are notified on Slack. So because we know that, you know, if there's a success, we really don't need to take any action. But for failures, you know, we have these attachments coming in with the email. One is the HTML report, which shows which request failed. The jmeter JTL format, which can allow you further debugging if you open this file inside jmeter and, you know, go to the exact request and what was the response. You can also view the HTML of the page there, so you can, you know, realize what was the actual error that showed up on the page. And this is the success and failure notification on Slack. So as you can see, you know, on July 17th, the test failed once and then, you know, subsequently it succeeded for both the tests. So it could have been a, you know, a server issue or a server reset that caused this failure, but ultimately because there was no bug in the application, it succeeded subsequently and, you know, after 25 minutes of the test. So we've also included some configurations in terms of, you know, if a build fails, try to run it three more times before it, you know, and if it fails even the third time, then stop, which means that there is a serious problem with your website and you need to do some fixing quickly. Apart from that, there are some configurations that you can also do in Jenkins, which can, you know, say that your build has failed. So say, for example, you are always expecting that some things, you know, may cause errors. So you can specify some allowances. There are greater than 1% errors, only then report a failure. Or say, in terms of performance tests, you could specify that if from the previous build, the response times are 5% to 10% higher, then report it as a failure. So these are some kinds of, you know, tweaks that you can do based on how your web application performs or whatever needs in the application in terms of performance. And some best practices about, you know, development and best practices about whenever there is a failure or, you know, how do you test failure, let's try and fix it before, you know, commenting and not checking it and code. Have a lot of unit tests in place because this PRP, you know, giving lots of quality. So it really starts with the coding itself and then goes on to the QA process. And then when you have builds in Jenkins, we could fail builds for these different reasons, which is, you know, architectural breach in terms of code changes. If you deploy, you know, coder or some other module which will check code for coding standards, we could also deploy that. And, you know, if some standards are not met, your coding style could fail the test. more the better. So that's how I feel, you know, you can ensure your application stability in your projects. So that's what I wanted to share. If you have any questions, comments.
You could also compare with the percentile response time or the median of the response times.